Hey guys, TJ Schwarz here. It's Monday morning here in the shop. I'm really excited. It's a big day. It's a big week. I'm actually machining a bunch of handle scales for my fixed blade Overland right now. It's a fixed blade knife that I make, and I'm wanting to have one of every color that I offer machined by the end of the day today. I've already got most of them done, but I want to show you guys what I'm working on right now. So you can see what I got going so far. A few different G10 colors. I've got a canvas micarta option and a couple other G10 colors that I'm still getting finished up. Now, the next one up is JG10, kind of a fan favorite, popular demand kind of material here. And the thing about this sheet, as opposed to the sheet that I machined those out of, is that the overall form factor is a little bit smaller. Now, here's what it looks like. I'm going to show you exactly how this works, but this is just kind of a broad overview. I start with a piece about that big, put it in the machine, and I machine out these handle scales. Now, this bigger sheet, when I cut it into quarters, which is what I'm gonna do, the sheet, each individual little piece is gonna be smaller than that by a fair bit, which is gonna cause a few little issues with the way that I machine it. That's something I'm gonna have to figure out, and I'd like to be ordering this bigger sheet like this in the future on all the colors, and so I'm gonna show you what I'm dealing with and how I'm gonna fix it. So once again, this is the remnant from a red handle set that I machined out. This is G10, about 3/16 thick to start with. I'm doing this arguably the simplest and maybe the most effective way to make a settle handles like this without having to build a lot of fixturing. I may eventually do that, but I'm actually loving this system, and so I was going to show you how it's done. Now, I take a blank piece of G10. I'm actually going to grab one that hasn't been machined yet real quick. This is actually micarta, but basically I set it in the vise. I line it up with the edge of the vise. I clamp it down. And then I can run a code that machines the handles out, leaving only tabs that hold it in. I then grab my Dremel here and I just reach in and cut the couple tabs and take the handles out. And this right here is the remnant that is left over after that. I think it's a great system. There's a couple huge advantages. Now, I'm gonna talk about those. So like the first one is I don't have to build a fixture. Obviously, this is the simplest way to get going making a set of handles. I mean, literally you put a piece of G10 in a vise that's already in there and you're good to go. But secondly, the big advantage that really kind of keeps me doing it this way is if you build fixturing and you have multiple operations, there's always the possibility that going from one operation to the next is gonna cause a tolerancing issue. Now let me explain. If I was machining this handle and I wanted to hold it down to machine the shape, the perimeter, the contour, all that, I would probably drill holes first in just like a blank piece of G10 and then mount it to a second fixture through those holes in order to machine the rest of the handle. That would be kind of common practice for making something like this. But the dilemma with that is, and it can be circumvented, but it's just the main weakness of that setup is that if you drill the holes and then you move it to a second fixture and start machining the perimeter, during that move, if there was any change in the way the machine sees the location of those two fixtures, in other words, the way the work coordinate system is set up, then it can machine the perimeter not perfectly in position around the three holes that were drilled in the first operation. And the problem with that is when you put it on your knife, if you have tight tolerances for how the handle fits around the perimeter, if the holes in relation to the perimeter is slightly offset, you have an issue where the scale looks like it's crooked on the handle. And so that obviously with good machining practices is totally avoidable. The Tormach holds plenty of tolerances. In fact, what I just described is exactly how I machine the tang of the knife. But the tang I don't feel like is doable in this style. So I do that. But like I said, I have to manage it very closely. It's something you have to pay a lot of attention to. Now, if you do it this way, you put the handle slab in here, it drills all the holes, and then it machines the perimeter without the part ever moving. That means that if your work coordinate system is off, it could be off by an eighth of an inch, but it does not matter. It literally has no problem machining the handle perfectly every time, no matter where this is sitting. I mean, there's almost no tolerance to really pursue besides like tool wear and things, because it drills the three holes, and it does all the machining, and it does the perimeter. Everything doesn't move, it stays still. And so the holes are always, always corresponding with the perimeter. And so that's kind of a powerful aspect to doing it this way. It does mean that I have to cut the tabs off and actually grind those off on my grinder, but it's super worth it. And G10 sands away super easily, like a 120 grit belt and then a light sandblast, and those little tabs are gone. So I'm super happy with the way I do this. Now, the little issue I'm running into, like I said, with the size of this piece is, as you can see, I can't get four of these pieces out of this. It's gonna have to be a smaller piece. In cam, I've confirmed that the handles will fit in a smaller piece, but I'll show you why that's a problem. Now, this vice jaw is what's called a step jaw. It's got flat level surface right here and then a kind of back wall lip. And these vice jaws can be removed from the vice and switched out, but this is what I configured for this operation. And so the material sits flush on the top of that surface right there. And then it's the just top lip of the jaw that actually compresses. Now, what you'll notice is where the end mill is going and doing the perimeter, it's dropping down inside the open area of this vise. And if this piece of G10 were narrower, even if the handles still fit, that end mill would puncture right, it would go through the G10 and it would go into this hardened jaw. And it being hardened, if I was using feeds and speeds that were appropriate for G10, it would snap that end mill in nothing flat. It would just snap it right off and the whole part would fail right there. So what I have to do is, this large of a surface is not important. I mean, it really only needs to be like a 16th or an eighth of an inch, just enough to support the underside of the material. This is kind of a low spindle load operation here. So I'm gonna take and machine some aluminum soft jaws. So these are pieces of aluminum that are just blanks, and they're meant to replace these hardened jaws, and they're just designed to be blanks that you machine away to be exactly the way you want them. Now, if I can essentially make my own version of this step jaw, but with a tiny, tiny little step, then with a smaller piece of G10, I'm gonna be set up just right to be able to do it. And that's the way I wanna do it going forward, so I'm gonna dive right in and show you how it works. So first things first, it's just a couple of really large hex Allens. I'm actually not gonna record myself doing this because I realize if I break that loose, I mean, I got a sharp tool here, which I should probably put away, and lots of stuff to bang my knuckles on, but you get the idea. Got the bolts removed. There's a little bit of surface tension of just some oil that kind of has it suctioned on there, but you can just take these jaws out. As you can see, that's essentially what we're making, except with a smaller step. Here we go. Before I put the aluminum jaws in there, I am gonna clean this all up, get all those chips kind of flowing down into my filter down below. It's just hard to get jaws in there without getting chips stuck in everything, without having a clean machine. So, a little overdue. I was machining a bunch yesterday, and now it's time to clean her up. I've got an auxiliary hose that I tap into the spindle coolant. And this is how I clean the machine up. Works pretty good. All right, she's not perfect, but the vise is pretty clean. I've blown it out with a bunch of air, got all the chips out of my way. Now I can cleanly put these soft jaws in. So you can see there's a bunch of extra material left to be machinable. That's gonna give us all kinds of freedom. I'm actually not gonna use the like programming side of things to machine these because it's just a simple little cut. I'm just gonna do it manually, which is kind of fun, so I'll show you how that works. I've got the jaws in. As you can see, they haven't fully come together yet, and I'll show you why. I've got 3/8 3-flute uncoated carbide end mill. And because it's 3/8 and I want a 1/8 shelf on each side, if the gap between the jaws is 1/8 of an inch, and I take this tool and put it right on the center line, and I drop it down a little bit and run it across nice and slow, then I'm gonna have a 1/8 step on each side with a 3/8 wide tool. Hope that makes sense. Now, how you actually get these jaws to be the right width apart, and one thing to note, the outside moving component of the jaw has a little bit of play, and usually the only way that it actually is firm enough that you'd want to machine on it is when it's actually clamped. So anytime you're machining a soft jaw, I would recommend clamping something. Now, this is an old knife plank I've got from an old model, and it's surface ground exactly 1/8 of an inch. So if I put the blank in between the jaws and then bring this puppy in, having that blank in between there ensures that everything is tight and there's no movement in this jaw, but that gap is an eighth of an inch. Now for centering this over that jaw, I'm actually gonna use my probe, which means I might actually open these jaws back up a little bit, come in and probe off that back wall, because I can't fit a probe tip inside of an eighth inch gap. So I open the jaws up and I park the probe right in between the jaws. The cord goes and connects to the user interface here, and I just pick the correct graphical visual here. So I'm probing the Y, and when I hit probe Y and set work origin, it'll set the Y0 to be that plane. So I'm gonna hit the button. So now the zero plane in the Y direction is that back jaw. Now, if you remember correctly, we do have to remember that if we want the tool on center, once this is tightened down to an eighth inch gap, we have to add a 16th of an inch over either to the work offset or just in our MDI line to get the center of the tool on the center of that. So I'm gonna get back to that 3/8 tool and we're gonna get ready to make this cut. So I'm gonna show you guys how I would use the MDI line to machine this. And by MDI line, I mean typing in coordinates rather than writing a program on your PC and then transferring it. So for example, firstly, I want this tool to be on that center. Now I'm remembering that if that back jaw is Y0, this is the negative Y direction, this is the positive Y direction. So to center the tool up, it needs to be in the position negative 0.0625, and that would be 1/16 off of that zero plane. So I go Y negative 0.0625, and then when I hit enter, you'll watch, centered up. Now, same thing, if I go to Z, and if I want that to be, let's say 100 thou deep, so I'd go Z minus 0.0, well, let's go actually 150 thou deep. Now watch, and make sure that your tool does clear the side of the part before you drop the Z. But as you can see, I'm 150 thou deep and I'm on center. Now the reason the X doesn't matter is because we're just gonna cut all the way across until we clear it. Now, if I go ahead and start the spindle, so doesn't need to be crazy high RPM, I'm gonna do 3500. I'm no pro machinist, so this is just gonna be a guess, you know, how I would do it. And then if I go forward, so the spindle's turning forward, 3500 RPM. Feed rate, I'm gonna do like 30 inches per minute, hit enter. Which then I'm gonna use my jog wheel here. So by selecting the X and then turning this little knob, I can actually move the tool. So this is a pretty deep cut, so I don't wanna go super fast. And now to make the finish just a little bit better on the bottom of that pocket, which is where it really matters, I'm gonna bump this up to, let's say, 6,000, enter. And then I'm gonna go in the Z direction. I'm gonna go Z minus 0.152. So that's gonna drop it 2 thou from the original 150 depth. You probably won't see it move when I hit enter because it only moves 2 thou. But then, if I go back across with some speed, it's just gonna do a nice cleanup pass. There we go, I'm gonna see how I like that.
It's exactly what I'm looking for, guys. I just have that little eighth inch shelf. I do need to do a little deburr on this. There's some sharp edges, but I'm pretty happy with that. Now, one thing to actually note here, I'm gonna show and compare this this hardened step jaw. They relieve that corner because the corner of a square end mill,
unless it's brand new and you've made the first like 1 inch of cut, it's never going to have like a true 90 degrees on that corner. It's actually that inside corner might have like a tiny radius where the tool wears just a little bit. Now, when they make these in the factory, you can tell they relieve it with a special tool to do that extra cut so that you always have clearance. And if you drop a part that has a 90 degree corner, it's not going to like snag on that corner radius and sit kind of wonky. Now, I'm not that worried about it, but if you were worried about it, one thing you could do is either try to figure out a way to relieve it, or when you put a piece of G10 in, take a piece of sandpaper and go along the two edges that are going to sit in there just real quick and make sure that that has an edge break so that it will sit all the way flat in the bottom. Next up, cutting the G10. Some people might wonder how I'm going to do it. A lot of people use a bandsaw. I don't, because if you use a bandsaw, you don't end up with straight enough edges to get a good clamping force from the step jaw. You want true 90 degree flat cuts. Now, you can use the table saw, but what I use that's great, simple, cheap little chop saw. I've got carbide tipped fine cutting blade in there, and it works great. Now guys, normally I would do this outside. I would have a bunch of G10 that I was gonna break down all at once, and so I'd take my saw out on the back patio. I'm just gonna do this real quick. I'm actually gonna leave the saw right here under the table. I don't have a big enough flat space to set it up in here, so this is gonna have to do. Make sure if you ever cut G10, use one of these guys, safety glasses, all the good stuff. Stuff's kinda nasty. So we got a little problem. I kind of wondered about this and now it's bearing out in real life. So with these jaws being so much thicker and I have only so much travel on my vise, this piece only barely doesn't fit. I guess it does fit barely, but the vise here is maxed out. And so if I wanted to use the same jaw to do both this style, like I was mentioning earlier, and this smaller piece, this vise is not gonna work. So decision time, I either machine back kind of a bigger step down here for clearance for that end mill and then have another smaller step, or I have to change my jaws out if I'm going to do a different style. I'm going to test it like this for the sake of this video. In the future, I might actually just machine maybe like 1/2 inch to 5/8 of an inch down most of the way back through the jaw and then add another little step like this so that I don't restrict my G10 size that I can use with it. Something that crossed my mind, but as you can see, it does fit. So I'm gonna give this a shot, show you what it looks like. So before I run this handle set, I wanted to show you step by step how I programmed it. Here's the finished part before I actually take the, you know, cut the tabs. And so starting at the top, you've got a perimeter slot, and the slot, I use a 3/16 end mill for this, and I leave 50 thou of material thickness below the slot. So obviously on the first cut, it doesn't go all the way through. And the reason for that is to have clearance where when I do my surf pattern and all that stuff, I'm not hitting larger areas of G10 that's unnecessary. So then I through drill, which is only a 3/16 hole. And then I actually interpolate the hole up to 1/4 inch, which is what my hardware diameter is. And I like interpolation over drilling a lot of the time because you have more control over the diameter. You can really dial it in to fit your hardware the way you want it. And then I counterbore for clearance. Then I surf it, and surfing is essentially a tiny, tiny step over. I think this is about a 10 thou step over. I've got a 1/4 inch ball end mill, and I've found that going perpendicular to these angle changes in the part is working the best and giving the cleanest finish. It means the tool is changing direction a lot. Originally, I had it running this way along the length of the handle, and as the lines would drop down into these areas, I was just getting some weird anomalies just because such shallow direction changes, for whatever reason, weren't being as high resolution as this direction. But then there's a chamfer around the perimeter, a few chamfers on the holes and whatnot, and then the tab contour. So After the part is essentially machined, you can see it's a finished part inside there. A tab contour comes in and it leaves tabs. It just drops in, plunges, and cuts through that final 50 thou. And you want to make sure that you do the tabs dead last no matter what, because you wouldn't be able to machine on this part with only those tabs holding it. This is enough material to keep the rigidity up, and this is only right before you remove it. Now, when you design this part, make sure you have enough margin on around the part so that when you squeeze it in the vise and you cut this first slot, if there's not enough actual rigid G10 material around the parts, it can become too flexible and be prone to vibration if you don't have it set up right. So that's how I do it. I'm going to show you how it works in the machine.
So I've got the code loaded. I've got the G10 loaded. I have this all probed in, so just a quick note on that. I probed the surface that the G10 is sitting on as the zero plane. That way, no matter what the thickness of the G10 is, because it's going to fluctuate from piece to piece, it's still going to be the same thickness of part, because the zero plane is always going to be the same. Now, I also, for the X zero plane, that's this surface, and for Y, it's that surface of the jaw. So this corner on the bottom of the sheet is the zero. And the reason for that is because this isn't a super precision setup, I can take a piece of G10, I just put it in, make sure the corner is lined up right here, push it all the way down, clamp it down lightly, just enough, because you don't want, the worst possible thing would be if you were to bow this handle material, you would end up with a not flat surface on the bottom. And then with all that being the setup, it's just put a piece of G10 in on the corner, tighten it, hit go, and it's super simple, guys. This is such a good way to do it. I really like it. There's some pros and cons, but man, I'm just liking this setup. Now, another note, the coolant pressure is gonna appear to be pretty dang low. That's because the coolant is running through a filter, and the filter is kind of towards the end of its life. And you may think, you know, change the filter before you get going, but I'm not worried about heat. And with G10, heat is never an issue. You could machine this totally dry at full feeds and speeds, but the problem with G10 is dust. And just having coolant just pouring onto it captures all the dust and runs it down and goes through the filter. And so that's the way I choose to do it. Some people run it dry and they'll put a vacuum fixture here that just sucks all the dust up. I think the best way to keep this really toxic dust down is just to run coolant, filter that. Maybe in another video I'll talk about my filter system and all that good stuff. But yeah, so anyway, I'm gonna hit cycle start and I'll show you how this thing goes. As you can see, it's gonna start out by doing that slot at full depth, moving pretty quick. I'm at 40 inches per minute at 10,000 RPM. It machines really well. So it's gonna machine both slots. Now it's gonna drill some holes. Drills super easily. Now it's interpolating the holes, making them full diameter. All right, guys, I got the feed hold on. I wanted to show you something. The spindle's still spinning. I don't want to interrupt the code. The first handle machined really nice, but I noticed one thing that's going on, and it's been not a problem so far, but I think the two halves, the two walls of the G10 are not parallel, and I don't think I'm getting a good bite on that back corner. And I think there's quite a bit of resonation happening because of one corner not being secured very well. I'm gonna lift the feed hold and let it start on the other handle, and you're gonna be able to hear what I'm talking about. It sounds really bad. I don't think it's affecting the finish because G10 is so forgiving, but this is definitely a problem, and I'm gonna talk about it after this part's done. I'm gonna show you what my solution would be. You can hear that, but that higher pitch sound, that's what we don't want. machining is complete. Let's have a look.
Looks really good. So like I said, you could hear that resonation. I can actually feel on this side, it kind of makes a little bit of a tapping sound. Like I said, these two lines on the G10 are not parallel. Out of all the handles I've run, it's the first one to give me that issue to that extent. So in the future, if I put it in here and I can tap it, I need to take it back to the saw and figure out which side is out of square and clean it up. Now, there's two other possible ways that I've thought that would improve this over the long run, and that would be for these grabbers on the side to actually be undercut with a dovetail cutter so that it's more of like a knife blade that is like biting the material so that it has just a sharper, tighter interaction. And the second thing would be to cut these down to a single handle width and just do one handle at a time. That way you don't have such a span. But I think if I actually cut more parallel in the future, it's just gonna be totally fine. Like I said, I've ran quite a few this way. Now, I'm kind of glad that happened on video though, because it shows a weakness of this design and kind of, you know, how you could resolve it. But I'm still happy. Like I said, the actual part looks really good. If it was anything other than G10, that chattering would be an issue. G10 is just so easy to machine and it's very forgiving. So I'm gonna get my Dremel and I'll show you how I cut those out. I cut them in machine. You could pull it out and then cut it, but I would be weary of that because you're just gonna, you know, spread G10 dust wherever you are. In here, at least it's already got coolant on it. It just kind of throws off like mud and it stays in the machine where it belongs. So I'm gonna do one cut here. I'm gonna do the rest off camera, but you get the idea. Part just drops out, you're good to go.
There they are, guys. I think they look really good. I'm gonna show you how I grind these tabs off and one last step for finishing. This is a 120 grit belt, going fairly slow on my belt sander. I got a table holding the part at 90 degrees. So the 120 grit grinds it right away. And once you've got it totally ground away to your liking, as you can see, it's kind of white, but that's just because it's dry. When the oil covers it, it's gone. 120 grit is, in my opinion, the perfect grit for G10. It removes it quickly, and the scratches basically disappear due to the layered material and the way this G10 is. One side note about this, guys. I was very strategic in where I put these tabs such that they would be easy to grind off. And by that, I mean I put them all on a convex surface of this part. As you can see, if there was a tab in this area where your finger goes, you wouldn't be able to grind it very easily. But all of them being on convex surfaces means when you push up to the grinder, you can kind of just rock it and just polish it right away. If it was inside there, as you can see, that would be a nightmare. You can use a small wheel, but just put them on convex surfaces, you'll be great. So the last step in this finishing process is a light sandblast. So from a distance, this gun has glass media in it. I'm running at quite a bit of PSI, so I want to stay a distance away. And I do two kind of quick passes across the top and two quick passes on the bottom so that it matches top and bottom. So with a sandblasted finish, you're gonna get washed out color, especially on the more saturated colors. And the reason for that is you've kind of textured the surface, and you might be kind of alarmed when you first pull it out of the sandblaster and clean it off at how like blonde it looks. But I can tell you the quickest little touch up is you throw WD-40 on it and you oil these scales. I would highly recommend that after doing anything with G10, and it brings out the color insanely well. I mean, here's some that I already oiled there. This is my Carta, but as you can see, the difference between unoiled and oiled. So here they are on a knife, guys. It's the first time I've assembled one with jade. He looks really good, such a cool color. Now, one thing to keep in mind, like I said earlier, that the benefit of doing it this way and the way I machine the handles is for the edge tolerance in relationship to the holes. So I don't know if it'll show up on camera, but the reveal as the handle leads up to that chamfer is super consistent top and bottom. all around the knife. And that's something that is always going to be the case as long as the tangs are machined correctly. The handle is going to have holes that are centered inside that profile correctly. Now, one closing thought. The reason that I wanted all these handles to be done today and have one of each color, there's still one color missing, yellow, which I'm going to machine. The reason I wanted them done today is I'm doing product photography because this knife, the Fixed Blade Overland, on my site is going to be launched with a configurator. So you'll be able to choose between these handle options. And I want the product photography to represent all of the different options. Now, by the time this video is posted, that configurator will be live at schwarzknives.com. That's S-C-H-W-A-R-Z. So if you want to see all the different options and kind of see, you know, what it would be like to build your own knife with all your custom specifications, go ahead and check my site out. A like, a comment, and a subscribe, or just one of those three, goes a long ways in helping me in terms of the YouTube algorithm. If you guys like the content, if you want me to do more, please do so. Just interacting in some way is just so beneficial for me. I really appreciate it. I had a lot of fun today. I hope you guys like the work that I'm doing, and I'll catch you later.